Range.
Oh no.
Range.
It's Tommy. You're back from the zombie apocalypse.
Range. Worms.
Welcome back, Davi.
How's it going?
I heard it was a rough time with those zombies. You fought them off? What happened?
Now, I had to crush some skulls and stuff, but luckily libertarians are immune to the virus. So, you know, a couple bites and scratches, but I'm A-OK.
Good to hear that. Boy, it's good to have you back. I was just chatting with Stefan about his sorcery. Being a patent attorney, it's like he casts magic spells. You have to know the right words to say in court, and you have to know all these silly rules that govern property, like, over ideas. Sounds kind of crazy to me. And it sounds like he doesn't even believe in these patent things, but he's doing it anyway, to protect the people. What kind of people have you protected, Stefan?
Oh, my Lord. I have a lot of private clients that.
Oh, okay. Well, you don't have to.
I can't divulge, of course, but sure. Yeah, I give people advice on DMCA takedowns and patent trolling issues all the time.
So, what's a DMCA takedown?
Well, that would be something you guys brought up recently on your show. The DMCA is the Digital Millennium Copyright Act. I think it was enacted.
Sounds high tech.
Yeah, it was an extension of the copyright law, and.
Back from 1790?
Well, the copyright law is like 1790.
But so they added something to a law from 1790, just stacked it right on top. This'll fit.
I think Bill Clinton did this. I think it was 1998. I think it was when I was a fairly new lawyer. And the one good thing about the DMCA was that it added this thing called, it was a safe harbor. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, I don't think it would be added now, just like if you poll Americans, would you support the First Amendment or whatever? If you just read them the text, they'll say, no, that's crazy. It wouldn't make it right now. It inadvertently added a provision that allowed the internet to flourish, which was this DMCA takedown system, which says that if you are an ISP or some kind of internet service provider, and you have content posted by your users on your site, like comments or blog posts or whatever.
Sure.
If it is infringing someone's copyright or if it's a defamation claim, remember I mentioned that earlier, under previous law, it wasn't clear whether the ISP would be liable under secondary liability provisions of the law for what their users did.
Hmm.
These laws made it clear that you would not be liable for your users' actions if you complied with the DMCA takedown procedure.
Which is what? What's the procedure? Fill out a form?
That,
go complain
which is
to
that
the government?
You're not liable for what your users do if you comply with a takedown notice by someone who complains about what they did.
Oh, man. This makes – it
this
seems
– So you're essentially saying that the DMCA policy at YouTube is not really set by YouTube. It's set by this law.
Of course. 100%.
Okay, so all of these sayings that like a DCA complaint is an appeal to a private company, which is YouTube, is false. This is an appeal to law.
It's 100% appeal to law. Completely false that it's a private system. It's simply what these companies have been forced and coerced into doing because if they don't comply – they could potentially be bankrupted because of the outrageous copyright fines that they could be subjected to under secondary liability for the actions of anonymous web users. But if this system had not been put in place inadvertently in 1990s, we wouldn't have had YouTube. We wouldn't have had Facebook.
Why not?
Because there's too much liability for all the content that's posted by the users of these sites.
Yeah, but couldn't they just not have a rule and then let everyone be fine?
So if we didn't have the DMCA's safe harbor provision, then
you think that internet service providers would be held liable for things like slander when their users type comments on a website that are slanderous.
And copyright infringement, too. So if a user posts a YouTube video which has a clip of a song in it in the background. Like, say you take a movie of your daughter dancing at a party, yeah, and there's a Michael Jackson song in the background, and you post that onto YouTube, then under conventional copyright rules, YouTube could be liable for copyright infringement as a secondary infringer along with the user. So what they would obviously do is they just wouldn't allow any of that. So wow. YouTube would not have existed. Facebook wouldn't have existed.
This is news to me. I had no idea that a law could actually do some good. We've talked about patents crushing innovation in the market. Next, I want to ask about patents affecting artists.
You're listening to Freedom Fiends with Michael Dean and his weird friends, tasing you with liberty since 2011. Learn more at freedomfiends.com.